And if we can have your attention, we will just play that clip so that you can actually hear it. Road to Bethlehem is coming to Adelaide. I had the opportunity to be involved in one of the very first Road to Bethlehems over in Melbourne, almost 20 years ago now, in fact was 20 years ago, and that has now grown and really doing a great job, and it's coming now to here to Adelaide. I'm excited to know that that's taking place. And this is something that is for all of our churches across Adelaide to be involved with. The details are there. It's held over three nights, 8th, 9th and 10th of December. For those of you who don't know what Road to Bethlehem is, it is essentially a walk through of the Christmas story, the birth of Jesus, with going from scene to scene, actors in full costume presenting the Christmas story in a dramatic fashion. And it is something that is well worth supporting, especially inviting your family and your friends to come along. It'll be held at Prescott College Southern, and the dates are there on the screen. Free, but you do need to book to reserve your tour time, because the way it works is that there are tours running every evening at set times. So you need to book your slot as to when which session you will be able to go through. Check out the website, roadtobethlehemsa.org. I understand that there will be flyers available in the next week or so, and you'll be able to use that to distribute to family and friends. Andrew.
Yes, good morning, everybody, and happy Sabbath to you all. It's really good to see this place. I'm just looking, just about full, and there are quite a few people still outside finding their way inside. Let me tell you about this afternoon, because a number of you have said, what are we doing this afternoon? We've entitled the program, Fishing is Easy When You Know How. And so what we're doing, I guess we're continuing, Joseph, the theme of the day. Remember in Sabbath school we were told, rise and shine, why? Jesus is coming. And our program and our worship time is called Witness. And this afternoon we're keeping that going, and fishing is easy when you know how. So please, you will really enjoy this program all the more because we have some special guests in town, and you will meet them in just a few minutes. We have Endless Praise and Endless Praise. Thank you for coming to Adelaide, and we're looking forward to your singing to us and singing with us. And this afternoon, as part of the program, Joseph, we're doing a little mini concert. So there'll be some talking, and then there'll be some singing, and there'll be some more talking, and there'll be some more singing. We'll hope to start at 2 o'clock. We don't want to run too late, because we know there's a beach there that you'd like to go for a walk on to enjoy the rest of the Sabbath. So we'll be starting straight after our lunch together, 2 o'clock, and that will be a really, really good program. Now, let me just talk about camp, or do you want to talk about Empower? Big Camp is coming up next year, 2016. It's in the bulletin there. Please block out April 17 to 23. We've entitled our camp next year, Overflowing. And this will be a camp that will really be overflowing. So make sure you come to Big Camp 2016, Overflowing. Now, Joseph, there's another... before we get to the other program, you'll notice also in the bulletin, we have quite a deal of Beyond DVDs that are still in the office and not being used. Now, folks, if you have any friends who would like to see these DVDs, we are giving them to you free. But if you can give a little bit of a love offering, that would be marvellous. So out the back there, let me point to the right direction. I think they're over there somewhere. If you would like to take some Beyond DVDs to give to your friends, please get them after the program. Joseph.
One of the things that I've been really impressed about South Australia is the last few years running here has been the Empower training weekends. And we have had them now for the last 3 years, is that right? And so by the grace of God, we are planning our next one February 2016. The weekend of the 20th, that's the Sabbath, I think that's the Sabbath that he falls on, 20th, 21st. We have, as our guest speaker, someone that I'm really looking forward to, someone that I have really been impacted by, and that is Pastor Tom Evans. You will not want to miss hearing this guy speak. We're really privileged to be able to have him actually be in Adelaide at this time. He'll be visiting Australia and spending some time on the East Coast earlier in the month, and so we're really fortunate to have him to be able to come here. And we'll say more. You'll see more of it in your churches, in your bulletins. But February 2021, Empower 4 with Tom Evans. If you are really serious about our church and really, really wanting to see how we can be more effective, I really place it on your heart that you ought to make yourselves available for that entire weekend, because you will not regret hearing Tom Evans. He's an incredible man of God.
You healed me, you provide for me,
and you're beautiful.
Good morning, church. Happy Sabbath. Who knows Hebrews 10:25? Anybody? That's one of my favorite texts. It says, "Do not forsake the assembling of one another together, as is the manner of some, but exhort each other always, especially as you see the day approaching." And do we not see the day approaching? Welcome everyone to Regional today. It is such an amazing privilege to be here, to come together and assemble with one another, to exhort one another, to learn and to praise Him in such an amazing place in the presence of God this morning. I hope you all have a blessed Sabbath, and I invite you guys to stand now as we sing our first song, Shout to the Lord.
Well, good morning, everyone. My name's Andrew, and we've got a small group here from the Adelaide City Church. It's great to be with you here today. And as we move into our time of prayer and worship, we're just going to read a special responsive reading. And I'd like you all to participate. Don't worry, it is a Sabbath day, so I don't want you to work too hard. But I'd invite you to follow the prompts on the screen as we proceed. Thank you. You will receive power.
You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and in Samaria and to the ends of the earth.
To the very ends of the earth.
Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. But how can they be saved?
And how can they hear without someone preaching to them?
And how can they preach unless they are sent?
As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news.
Oh yes, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news.
Then Jesus came to them and said, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you.
Surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age.
Amen. And this gospel of the kingdom.
Amen.
Hello. Popcorn. The kids had popcorn this morning. And today we're going to be doing popcorn prayer. There's something unique about popcorn. Something so small can get to something so fluffy and unites people to smile. So I'm going to ask you to bow your heads or kneel, whatever you feel comfortable, as we talk to our Father.
Dear Heavenly Father, please bless all the kids and boys in the world and bless our hearts with the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for today. Thank you for everyone here. Thank you for the girls and babies. And I ask you that they can learn about you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God Almighty, I ask for all the women in this church, Lord. I ask for the ministry that we serve in within our church, and I ask you to please guide us and help us always.
Dear Lord, as we come before you, I pray for our fathers, our sons, especially our men and our grandparents, Lord. I pray that you will bestow a new heart, because we are broken, but we come to you pleading, make me clean again, Lord. I ask you, Lord, that you may bless us, look after us, and keep us safe. And Lord Jesus, come soon, because we need you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. come with all I am. Lord, use me for your plan. I'm letting go.
There comes a time in life, for all of us eventually, when you know it's time. Time to leave full-time employment and move into another chapter of life. And I thought, seeing there are so many of us here today, that it would be fitting and appropriate to honour and thank Pastor Glyn and Heather Slade for the huge contribution that they have made in our conference. Amen, everyone. So I'm going to ask Glyn and Heather if you'd like to join me on the stage, please. After much thought and prayer, Pastor Glyn and Heather Slade have decided to retire at the end of the year. And I think if we think back, the Slade name has been a part of our conference for quite a number of years. First with Darren, Glyn and Heather's son, who served here in Adelaide for a number of years, and now Mum and Dad themselves, Glyn and Heather. You made the trek over here probably at the end of 2004, ready to begin your work 2005. Yes, when you were asked to care for the Kadena and Port Pirie churches. A little later, 4 years I think it was, you moved here to Adelaide to look after our churches at the Grove, and also Trinity Gardens. During that time, Glenn, I think you were ordained to the gospel ministry. And I remember you saying to me that the only regret you had was that you hadn't begun your ministry lots and lots earlier. In 2013, you moved north to Bury to care for the Riverland and Cokeville churches. Then last year, you realised that the 70-year mark was fast approaching, and you felt it was probably time to hang up your harness. And Glenn, we want to honour you and thank you for all the work that you've done here in South Australia. And we have a citation that we've prepared for you, which you can hang on your wall at home as you leave us. I won't read the whole lot, I'll just read a little bit. Glenn Barry Slade, we thank you for your outstanding contribution to the work of the church in South Australia. We acknowledge your dedication to ministry, enhanced by your passion and ability to shepherd congregations in a caring, Christ-like manner. We honour you for the way you have allowed God to work in and through you throughout the ministry he has called you to. Many lives have been impacted and will be in the harvest for eternity due to your labour in his fields. And then it's signed by Pastor George Munoz, our new AUC President, Brendan Pratt, our AUC Ministerial Secretary, Joseph Maticich, our Ministerial Secretary in this conference, and myself as President. So, Glenn, what I'll do, I think I'll give that to you now. And thank you so much for what you've done. And God bless you in your next phase of life. Thank you. Now, behind every good man, they tell me, my wife says, is an even better woman. Amen, ladies?
Amen.
who's very exhausted. And Heather, I think we need to just acknowledge what you've done in this conference too. I remember Heather on our executive committee asking all the questions, Joseph, that probably other people weren't going to ask, especially when it came to matters financial. And so, Heather, we want to thank you for the work that you have done in our conference over the years. And we have a little plaque for you too that you can hang together with Glenn's. The Seventh-day Adventist, this is to Heather Jean Slade. Is that right? With grateful thanks. The Seventh-day Adventist Church in South Australia would like to sincerely thank you for your commitment, energy and dedication given to this conference from 2005 to 2015. For your unstinting support of Glenn and his ministry. For your work in caring for the SAC worship ministry. For your organisation of conference camp events, and we remember those with great fondness. For your organisation and coordination of the 2011 Ancient Mysteries program. And that was a huge undertaking, let me add, for that year 2011. And I seem to think that there are a few illness issues around there as well. For your organisation of the Institute of Worship Orchestra Convention visit in 2013. For your assistance with the accounts of Prescott College, for your serving on the executive committee for two terms, for giving of yourself to strengthen and grow the church in South Australia. So, Heather, we also would like to acknowledge and thank you for what you've done in this conference. Folks, we're going to miss these people. They have done so much in our conference and they've become very much a part of us. But I do believe, Glenn and Heather, that you're moving over to the East Coast and finding a property somewhere there in the central coast of New South Wales, if you can find one for the right price, and that's where you'll settle, which is a fine place. But look, on behalf of all of us here, we would like to wish you much of God's blessing and all the very best. And I think Kay has something also for Heather that she would like to give you. And after that, we're going to ask Pastor Joseph just to pray, unless you'd like to say a few words. Yes, sure. All right, so before we pray, Glenn, there's a microphone for you there. Thank you.
Folk, I just want to say a couple of things. One is a big thank you to the conference administration. I think we had the best start in ministry that any person could have wished for. We had support, we had love, we had guidance, and I truly mean it when I said I wish I'd started sooner. We have loved our time serving, I think, seven churches, if I've got it right. And it's been a blessing to us. And I want to thank you too, as the folk, for I got to know you all, or a lot of you anyway, Thank you for your support and for looking after us. South Australia is a great place. The only reason we're leaving it is we have a little grandson on the East Coast, and I only have one, so I'm going to enjoy it. So thank you, folk, for all that you have done for both my wife and I and for my daughter Polly over here. And we're going to miss you. But hopefully we'll be back from time to time just to check up, make sure you're still doing the right thing. May God bless you all.
I'm just going to invite you to bow your heads and we're going to pray for Glenn and for Heather. In fact, I'll stand here. Our loving Father in heaven, Lord, we count it a privilege to be able to be here today and to praise and thank you that you are a God who calls people at all stages of their lives. Thank you for Glenn and for Heather and for their willingness to respond to the call to come and to leave their business 10, 12 years ago and to come to South Australia to minister here. Thank you for their ministry. Thank you for the churches in which they have worked. Thank you for the lives that they have touched, people that they have spent time with, that they have shared, taught from your word, preached, baptized, and seen grow into become your disciples. Lord, we want to thank you for Heather and for the work that she has done in this conference as well. Lord, we thank you for Polly and for her support. And Father, we pray that you will be with Glenn and Heather and Polly as they relocate at year end, that move will happen smoothly. And Lord, we give you the praise for using these people, for their heart of responding to your call, forgiving of themselves. And rather than spending time selfishly in retirement, Lord, they've given it to you in service to you. And we give you the praise for that. We pray that you bless them. Bless them as they spend some time with their children, their grandson especially. And Lord, I pray that they will continue to be able to touch lives wherever they go, and that those that have been impacted by their ministry will continue to go on in following you. And so, Father, we commit them to you and ask that you bless them again in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
All right. We got any kids here? Hey, how about you come down the front? Come down the front and join me. I got a kid story to tell you.
Andrew, up on the stage.
All right, kids, you're going to go and join up on the stage up here. Amelia's going to lead the way.
Why not? She's beat. Here, have a seat.
Strike, we got heaps of them. This is great. Now, Mrs. Stefani, before I start this story, are you happy to help me out at some point? Just not yet, but in a moment. And Pastor Wolfgang, you will too. We ready? All right, you're going to sit, squash back a little bit that way. I need a bit of a stage. Squash back a little bit and eyes this way. Strike, we got more. Cool. All right. We may not fit. There's gaps all down the back there if you want. Yep. Squish back, squish back. Shuffle, 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 shuffle. Squish, squish. Push back, push back, push back. Push back, push back. Yep. Got some more. Didn't realize we had so many kids. This is cool. All right, put your hand up if you think you know who I am. Hands up. Oh, Jono, yes, you're right. I'm Missa And how am I Missar? Well done, Jono. Because I am not just a teacher at Prescott Primary Northern, but I'm the chaplain at Prescott Primary Northern. Pardon? No, I'm not a mother. Bad luck. All right. So this morning I have a story to tell you and to tell you. Our story today is about a young man called, some of you may know it already, but it's okay, called Conrad. Put your hand up if your name is Conrad. We got any Conrads? No, that's unfortunate. That's all right. Put your hand... No, Jono, your name's Jono. Put your hand up if you are maybe 10 years old. Do we have any 10-year-old young people? We do. Chelsea, you're 10. All right, fantastic. So, Chelsea, you've now changed for this time, and you're a boy. And your name is also Conrad. So, Monique, say hello to your new best friend, Conrad. Hi, Conrad. Let's wave to her. Hi, Conrad. All right, so Conrad is 10 years old, and this is actually a true story. It happened in 1799. Conrad lived on a very, very big farm, and in the middle of his farm, in the middle of his paddock, he had a very big, big dam or a little creek. I don't know which one, but it was some water. And he used to go down swimming in his creek. Can you show me how you swim? Adults, can you show me how you swim? So I think Miss Kay Zidervale down here did very well at swimming, but I think Charlie, you did pretty well as well. So Conrad there is swimming. Show me your swimming. And as he's swimming, he looks down. Ooh. And as a little boy, he notices something interesting. Does anyone know what he noticed? A rock. Well done. It was a little, this one's brown, but let's imagine, it was a little black rock. And it was down the bottom and he thought to himself, can you think to yourself? I think I want that rock. And so if you're at the top, what do you have to do? Duck dive down. And so he duck dived down and he kick, 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 kick. He put out his hand. Are you ready? And he bent down and he grabbed the rock and with a big pull, oh my word, that's a heavy little black rock. And he gets back to the top. Can you take some big breaths? Oh, it was hard. And so he thought to himself, well, I'm not one to give up. I'm going to try again. So he duck dived back down. Kick, 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 kick. Hold your breath, hold your breath, hold your breath. Pull your hand out. Pick it up. Oh, it was too much. So he thought to himself, well, how am I going to pick up my little black rock? How am I going to pick up my little black rock? So he thought, I know, I have a backpack over on the shore. So he swam over and he picked up his backpack. And then he started to swim back and he looked back down and he said, I've seen my little black rock. I'm going to have to pick this little black rock up. So he kicked back down. Kick, 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 kick. He puts out his hand. Oh! He now puts it into his backpack. Whew. He leaves his backpack there for a while. He comes back up. Yeah, you're doing that very well. And then he comes back down and he picks it up. Oh! On his back. He gets up. Now, if you've just found a little black rock, what's the next thing you're going to go home and do? Show your mum. And so he comes inside. He runs around. He comes inside. And then with a big, loud voice, he says, Mummy Stefani! Come here! And so Mummy Stefani runs to the door and says, Conrad, what have you found? Well, Mum, you won't believe it. It's just so exciting. Okay, and so with that, he puts down his backpack that's now all nicely wet. He puts out his hand, and remember, he's carrying this nice, heavy rock, and he takes it, and he puts it in her hand. Oh! And she says, Conrad, what the heck have you got?
I It's amazing, Mum. I found it in the back dam.
Wow, it's so heavy.
Yes. Can we keep it?
I guess.
No. Oh, but Mummy, please.
No.
Please, Mummy. So now, Conrad was a clever little boy and he thought, well, if Mummy has said no, there are how many parents in my family? Daddy Wolfgang! And so Wolfgang came running down. Daddy, Daddy, look! I found a rock! Ooh. Oh, Daddy, can I please, please keep it? Please? Oh, but please, Daddy. Please. And so with that, my little black rock stayed in our house for 3 years. Now, let's just think, and let me ask you a question. If you had a little black rock that is quite heavy, what would you use it for? A doorstop. And so the little black rock became a doorstop, except unfortunately, as Mummy Stefani was walking along one day, unfortunately, it got in the road and she stubbed her foot. Oh, it hurt so much. She looked at the rock. You've got to go. But Daddy Stefani, he was okay about the rock. He still liked it and I loved it. So, hey, it's staying for a while. Until one day when Daddy Stefani was going for a run to the fridge. He unfortunately also kicked his toe. At that point, his love for the rock changed. And it was also got to go. So with that, Mummy Stefani and Daddy Stefani both picked up the rock and they decided to take it to the shop. The shopkeeper was Mr. Kingston. And Pastor Kingston was standing here, ready to receive the little black rock that they brought in. They said, "How much will you give? How much will you give us for this rock?"
$3.
With that, they left. But Pastor Kingston, shopkeeper Kingston, was a very clever man. And he thought to himself, I think this rock might be special. So he went out the back. There. He took a big saw. And he chopped open our rock. And boys and girls, what do you think he found inside of our little black rock? Andrea? He found gold. You know, for 3 years, this little black rock was what? A doorstop. But inside was gold. It was sold for $3.50, and remember, this is a true story. And yet, at the time, it could have been sold for 1,000 times more. Do you know, each one of you are little black rocks. Some people might look at you and say, oh, you're just kids. Some people might look at us and say, oh, we're just a teacher, we're just whatever. But inside each of us, there is gold. Unfortunately, you know, most people in our lives don't know that they're gold. And it's our job to go and cut open the rock and to show them how special they are. Because who makes us special? God. In a moment, you're going to hear from some people today who have found out that, hey, they're actually like gold. You're special and they're special. And that's because who loves you? Who loves you? Amelia, who loves you? God. Jesus loves each one of you. Point to yourself and say, I am gold. Point to the person next to you and say, you are special. Point to the people out here, all these older people, and say, yeah, you're special too. Let's bow our heads and we'll say a prayer to finish. Dear Jesus, we thank you so much that we are gold to you. You look at us, and while many people see us as just little black rocks, but you see the worth inside of us. And Jesus, there's a whole world full of gold, a whole world full of people who perhaps don't know that they're gold though. I pray that at this time, we would be able to reach out and show them how much you love them and that they truly are so special. We pray this in your name. Amen. Thank you, Mummy and Daddy Stefani and shopkeeper Kingston.
Thank you, Annie, so much for that story. As you were telling that story, it just made me think of my favourite psalm, Psalm 139, and it talks about how much God loves us and how he knew us while we were being created in our mother's womb and how precious we are to him. And he thinks about us day and night. He knows how many hairs we have on our head. What an amazing, mighty, powerful God we serve, that he cares about us that much, that he thinks about us day and night and constantly. I also think in Revelation 4, there's this image being painted of these, I guess, creatures. And they've got six wings that are covered in eyes. And if you turn to Revelation 4, verse 8, they are saying, singing, shouting, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God, the Almighty, the one who was, who is, and who is still to come." We serve a holy God, a mighty God, a God that loves us. Stand and sing this song with us. Holy, holy, holy.
Oh, we're now going to have our offering time. And I have three little pieces of blue paper at the front. It's to express my love. We are going to praise him through offering giving. I was sitting next to Pastor Slade and he was telling me the story. I was sharing my story, which was I went to the Christian Verses group during the holidays. And those people prayed for the children in their schools. It was just wonderful. Pastor Slade tells me he's on the board of directors of the Rivergum School in the Riverland. I love to see children have the opportunity for Christian education. Today I have one blue piece of paper for each of my three schools that I love. Prescott Northern, Prescott College and Prescott College Southern. They are great schools and I love the people and the children who go there. So I would encourage you to give today to our school and our education offering. Bless and pray for the children in Christian schools. Amen. You just need to pick up the white dish that's on the end of your row and feed them in towards the middle.
Just the other week, I was on school holidays being a teacher, still doing work, of course. And during school holidays, it often gives me a little more time to just reflect and talk to God. And God spoke to me in a very special way. And it's something that I've always known, but for some reason, I was just sitting on my bed and I just thought, do you know what? I am such a sinner. I sin every week, every month, every day. I sin every hour. But I have a God who sent his son, who loves me so much that he got on a cross at Calvary and died for me. Just think about that. God sent his son to die for me, so that Calvary can cover it all. All the sinning that I do every single day, Calvary can cover it all. In Romans 8, verses 38 and 39, it says, I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love, neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today, nor our worries about tomorrow. Not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. No power in the sky above or in the earth below. Indeed, nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that he has revealed in Jesus Christ, our Lord. And because of that promise, because of the promise of Calvary, I can know that it is well with my soul. When I go through trials, when I'm low, I can also know that it is well with my soul. Will you stand and sing this beautiful song, Calvary? The Savior alone carried the cross. For all of my debts, he paid the cost. Salvation complete. Now forever I am free. Calvary covers it all, and it is well with my soul.
Jesus.
Their faces were shiny and their eyes were bright as they gathered around Jesus, their Saviour, their Lord, and their dearest friend. They all looked at him with awe and amazement, knowing that only a little more than a month before, he had been abused, scourged, nailed on a Roman cross with a Roman spear thrust in his side, that he had died, that he'd been taken down from that cross and laid in a garden tomb. They didn't quite know what was going to happen as they grieved on that Sabbath. But very early the next morning, as we all know, Jesus defeated death, burst out of that tomb after crying to God and to the universe that it was finished. And those 11 disciples learnt that with that cry came the freedom of this planet and the ultimate destruction of Satan, the self-proclaimed prince of this world. And so with questioning hearts and curious minds, they ask Jesus, they say, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" You see, they were curious about the next step, about Jesus' plan to bring the world to him. And in their minds, they thought that he might introduce the plan that God would reach the world through the nation of Israel, perhaps. And it appears that they did not fully understand the plan of the church, which Jesus had already told them about, as recorded in Matthew 16, when he said, "On this rock I will build my church," the church being the ones that will be called out. And now he tells them, as he looks at them, he says, "Look, it is not for you. It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you." Note the confidence of this statement. It says, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you." And then Jesus continues, "You will be my witnesses. You will share in what you know, what you have experienced, what you have seen in Jerusalem. And then you will tell Jerusalem. You will tell it in Judea. You will tell it in Samaria. And finally, this message will go to the uttermost ends of the earth." Jesus told them that they were to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing and teaching them everything that he had commanded them. He also told them, as they were sitting on the Mount of Olives, that this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a witness. That's that word again. To all nations. And when this is done, the end would come. And so those 11 men, which grew to 120 people filled with the Holy Spirit, has come the good news of Jesus. And today we find that a third of those living on this planet consider themselves Christians. That's 2.2 billion people. In our own church, as we see our role to proclaim Jesus in the context of end times and forgotten and distorted truths, well, we have a presence in 216 countries with a membership now that is nudging 20 million people. And yet, my friends, as we all know, there are many, many more people. People who have sad lives. People who are looking for hope. People who are looking for meaning and purpose in their lives. And this morning, something a little bit different. We're going to meet just some of those people. People who have just discovered or are discovering the joys of Jesus and the understanding of truth, the truth that can set them free. So I'm going to ask Pastor Lee to come with some guests, which he would like to meet. Pastor Lee is the pastor of the Queenstown Church. And we'll just get some chairs up here, Lee, so you can tell people how these people have met Jesus and how they're learning to know about him.
It's my pleasure today to introduce to you three beautiful friends that we have at Queenstown Church. It's Scott and Elisa and Zachariah Plager. They are people who have come to us. We didn't go and find them. They came and found us. And we were at that time praying that God would lead us to people who were being convicted by the Holy Spirit, or even lead people to us who were being convicted by the Spirit of God. And one day, Scott and Elisa just walked into church. And so, Scott, I'm wondering if you could share with us what brought you to the place where you came along to Queenstown Church.
Thank you, Pastor Lee. I've been a Christian since I was about 15 years old, and I'm a bit of a talker, so I'm going to cut a really long story short for you. My family's an atheist family, and I was an atheist until I was 15, so I've had no religious upbringing. When I was 15, I came to God in the Baptist church. I was baptized, and but I was a really naughty person, and although I knew the truth, I didn't really act it, which is ironic about what they were talking about today. Over the years, I went to some churches. I went to a church at Port, I think it's called Portside Church, for a short time, very short. And I went to the Pentecostal church in the city for a short time. My auntie introduced me to it. It didn't work for me. And when I was living in China for about 3 years, I went to a mixed denominational church there. But I never really found what I was looking for. It didn't really seem to strike the chord.
I think you did find what you were looking for. You found Elisa.
I found her at the church, actually. So I came back to Australia, and for 3 or 4 years in Australia, I didn't go to church again. I've always been really, really slack. I knew I should go to church. The church didn't appeal to me. It didn't really strike a chord. And when I listen to the radio, I drive a lot for my job. I drive around a real lot. I listen to the radio, and I hate commercials. I haven't watched TV for like 10 years. I can't stand commercials. I've got AdBlock Plus. On your computer, put AdBlock Plus. You won't get any ads. I hate ads. So when a commercial comes on, I flick to the next station. And this is great, because I know all the different stations, and I discovered this station, 88.8. And it turns out it's a Seventh-day Adventist station. And yeah, this is the short version, sorry. So I heard things that I knew were true, but in the other churches I didn't discover. And two of them, and I guess they were key, was that they worshipped on the Sabbath. And this was always an issue for me. I was like, why does everybody go to church on a Sunday for? That doesn't make sense, because the Bible says do it on a Saturday. And I was never given a good explanation for it. And when I approached my pastor in the church in China, they had a really long-winded excuse, which wasn't very biblical. So I thought, well, this church sounds interesting. And then there was talk of vegetarianism. And I'm not a vegetarian, but I'd like to be. I'm a bit slack, you know, I'm working on it. So I thought, well, that's the truth. And the only time I'd ever heard about that before was like New Age spiritualism, which was definitely not for me. So I thought, let's check it out. But I never did, because I was slack for about 2 years. And then finally, my radio stopped working for 6 weeks. It worked, but not for 88.8. And I thought, what happened to my station? Because I was starting to listen to it a bit now. So I thought, oh, I'm going to have to Google it. So I Googled Seventh-day Adventist. And then I found on the website there was this map, and the closest church was the one at Queenstown. So I thought, all right, got to do it, you know. So I went down there, and at first when I went there, I thought, oh, this is a bit quiet. But then I realized that it was the right place for me. The truth was there, and the people are great. So, we've been going there for a year now, and I'm not going anywhere. We're going to stay with the church. So, it's great. I can't believe we finally found the right place. So,
thank you. Yeah. Thank you very much, Scott.
Thank you, Lee.
Alisa. One day at church, I was speaking on a topic, and I don't know if you remember it, but after you heard me speak, you came up to me and you shared something that had been revealed to you during the sermon. Do you remember that day?
Maybe. Please, just...
I was speaking about a lady who had been dragged before Jesus.
Yeah, I do remember that one.
Yeah, and she had been caught in adultery with somebody else, in the act of adultery, and they wanted Jesus to do something to her.
Oh, yeah, I remember that one, that the lady, people said wanted to stone him, her to death.
Stone her, yeah.
And Jesus came to say, oh, let's stone her, and then the following what he said, it really surprised me. And he said, but let's stone who...
Those without sin cast the first one.
That surprised me. I came from a different culture,
yeah,
background, and I was thinking, oh, Jesus was so powerful, and when he came to say, oh, let's stone her to death, and I thought, oh, they might just do it, but then what they did is different. He came to save her, so that's the point.
So what did you learn about Jesus and about God that day? That was different to some of the background of the stone gods and the wooden gods that you had seen in Buddhism and other cultures in your country.
The gods everybody here believe in, he came to us.
So he came seeking us.
He came to seek us, and also he sacrificed himself on the cross for us.
Yeah.
Where the background culture where I was from, we have to sacrifice the food to what we are believing.
Yeah, so you would take food to the gods and you would appease the god that way.
Yeah.
But this Christian God was one who came loving you and seeking you in relationship with you.
Yeah.
Isn't that a beautiful change and different approach and understanding for you?
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah. While you were with us, you all of a sudden we realised that you were expecting a little baby. And, you know, he was born and he's so sleepy at the moment. And you called him Zachariah. And what a beautiful name, for it means the Lord has remembered. And the Lord has remembered both of you. And what has becoming a parent or parents helped you both understand about our Heavenly Father and His love for you?
For me, being a parent is quite a surprisingly different thing to not being a parent. It's a big surprise. The thing I discovered was that, well, when you're a baby, you don't really know anything. And I remember when I was younger and I thought I knew everything. Now I realise I didn't know anything at all. And now that I've had a baby, I realise just I really don't know anything at all. And that, I think, is like I can see the relationship issue, you know, like me, baby, God, me. It's almost the same thing. And it's an eye-opener.
So there's a lot to learn about God's love in the love that you show.
Yeah, and you got to have faith because you're not going to get it. They don't get it even when they're 18, so you're just not going to get it. Yeah.
So, Elisa, is there anything that you have learned about God's love for you in caring for this little boy?
Yeah, the first time I knew that I am going to have a baby, I was so excited. And I would try to learn everything that I'm going to put in his mind so he can grow in a good person. And then when I had him the first day, and then now he's 5 months old.
Yeah.
And I actually started to realize I learned from him more than I teach him.
Yeah.
So the first thing I learned from him is I have to learn his language. he's been trying everything to do to make him pick him up from bed or from when he's laying. And now I realize having a baby, bonding the whole family together, and stronger. And
so that's what God wants with us, a beautiful bonding relationship, a love relationship, and like you have with your little boy.
Yes, thank you.
Well, God bless you. I've got one last risky question. Have the people at Queenstown Church treated you well and befriended you both?
Of course. What are we going to do? Of course. We wouldn't have stayed at the church. They've been really, really, really friendly and helpful, all of them. It's a lovely church. I imagine that the other Seventh-day Adventist churches are the same. Just marvellous people. It's been very accommodating and not judgmental or critical or pushy. So it's been great. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you for your spiritual journey and sharing with us today.
Thank you,
it's
Pastor.
It's been great.
Thank you.
God bless.
Wasn't that wonderful just to hear these stories about how God is working in people's lives? Let's leave Queenstown now and go to Church in the Hills with Pastor Roland, who wants to introduce us to someone. So thank you very much, Roland.
Thanks, Pastor Andrew. My name is Roland and this is Chris. We attend Church in the Hills, which is a Seventh-day Adventist church plant in Para Hills. Chris, let's start off. Can you share a little bit about yourself? Green mic on, please. Yellow neon. Speak of this. Yeah, this one. Swap over. Okay. Let's start again. Chris, can you share a little bit about yourself? Put it up like that. Yeah. Talking to it. Is it on? Hello? Testing. 1, 2, 1, 2. Okay. It's all good. Okay, Chris, third time lucky, bro. Ready? Hey, tell us a little bit about yourself.
So, I'm from a town in New Zealand called Paraparaumu. Grew up with like older sister, younger brother, and older brother, mum and dad. Used to go out like tramping, hunting. Just a really nice place. Grew up going to church with mum, Catholic community. And then I moved over to Aussie 4 years ago, and I met Luana there, and then I moved over here just in February to Adelaide.
Nice one. So you're a Kiwi. Yeah. I was wondering why you were such a good guy. Awesome. Nice one. Hey, today we're talking about witnessing. Can you tell us a little bit about your Christian experience as a young person?
So when I was young, I had this idea of like heaven as like all these whiteboards of like all the good things you'd do and all the bad things you'd do, and like when I was real little, I was just trying to be real good, trying to because I'd pray to God all the time, and it's like. But when I got to, I guess when I started college, about 12 years old, I started getting into a lot of trouble, and I. As the years went on, I just grew further, and then I had no relationship with God whatsoever. Like, it was just me. I was just stupid, hurting people, drugs, alcohol, it's just in a bad place,
So about how long do you think it was that you actually lived the life apart from God? From 12 till about?
Probably since I came to Adelaide. Mm.
It's about just over 10 years or so, right?
Yeah.
Hey. So I guess about 6 months ago, we caught up at Macca's. And I invited you and Luana to come and check out a life group. How did you feel?
So I didn't know anyone here in Adelaide. Like, I knew Luana, but I didn't have family or nothing. So it was really nice. But it was a bit like we went to invited to Macca's, then got invited to church. It was a bit full on. But to be honest, like
Remember,
I wouldn't have come to church if you hadn't asked me that. Like, nice. I wouldn't have gone if it wasn't in that situation.
Okay. And how was your experience at that first life group meeting?
It was cool. It was good to see a couple of Kiwis, like there are heaps in Perth, and yeah, it was just fun. I felt, you know, really welcome. I was like, oh.
And you guys got a special venue for your life group. Where does this life group meet?
At McDonald's.
Okay, nice one. The local McDonald's.
Yeah.
How you get started? Hey, well, I guess, Chris, that was about 6 months ago, and you've been coming back to Church in the Hills ever since. Why do you keep coming back? I mean, we love having you come back, but yeah, why do you keep coming back?
So, like, there's Church in the Hills is like a small church, and it's like all the people there, like, I feel like they would do, they just do anything for you. Like, they will make time, like we do Bible study with Roland on Sundays. So busy, lots of people are going through some stuff, and they're always just really there. Just, it's the place where I've got to see Jesus again, got to have that relationship with him. And it's a place, like, there's a lot of young people, and I feel like I can understand, like, it all makes sense. Like, I guess I learn a bit differently, but I can just learn. It's easy there, and I just want to learn more, you know?
Hey, amen. Well, what difference has Jesus made in your life?
So, he's took me from, I guess, all the hurt that it's like, all the hurt is just slowly going away now. I don't think about all the bad things are done as much. Like, he lost his son for that, all my sins.
Amen. Amen. Hey, Chris, I got a new favorite word. It's the word enthusiastic. And the reason why I love this word, just listening to a sermon recently, and the pastor was saying that the word enthusiastic actually comes from the Greek word en, which means in, and theos, which means God. And he's just talking about, hey, that when God is in someone, or when we're in God, that we're enthusiastic. And I've been talking with a couple of leaders from Church in the Hills. Since you came just for our church a couple of weeks ago, we needed Church in the Hills. We're cooking at Adra Cafe. Needed some people to cook some lasagnas. I get a text from Chris and Juana, and they're like, yeah, put your hands together for Adra Cafe. Get a text from Chris and Juana, they're like, hey, we've never cooked a vegetarian lasagna before, but we want to chip one in. And so this guy finishes work, 8-hour shift, hard labor work, rushes home, makes his first vegetarian lasagna, and then he drives speed limit, keeping the speed limit, all the way to Adra Cafe to be there by 6:30. And I'm looking at this guy, Chris, and I'm chatting with the leaders, and I'm like, this guy out-enthuses me. He out-enthuses us. So tell us, bro, why are you so enthusiastic about serving and telling people about Jesus? Why? Tell us the secret. I've been a Christian for 43 years, but you tell me the secret.
There's no secret. It's just... I'm just happy I got to know God again, you know what I mean?
Amen.
Yeah, like that's it. Like, I used to know him, I lost it, I know him. Amen.
Praise God. Just going to finish off with two more questions, bro. Some of us, I was reading this book recently, and it said that 90% of Adventist Christians live their whole life without leading a single person to Jesus. 90% of Adventist Christians live their whole life without leading a single person to Jesus. And I know it's pretty tough because we're living in a country where if I tell people about Jesus, I could get whipped, beaten up, I could lose my job. Am I living in that kind of country?
No.
Oh, no, I'm not. Okay. So you mean the worst thing is that someone might say no. There's some Christians who have been Christians all their lives and they've never led anyone to Jesus and they're a little bit nervous. Can you say something to someone like myself who's been a Christian for ages, but I always get nervous about sharing my faith or witnessing? What would you say to someone like me?
Like, to be honest, all you can do is try. Like, if you don't try, then, well, you're just going to always be asking that question, you know what I mean? Just do it.
Man, just do it. I love that. Just do it. And last question. Maybe there could be someone in church today who, just like you 6 months ago, had been living life without Jesus. And living life without Jesus. After walking with Jesus again for 6 months, what would you say to someone who's in the congregation right now, who's living far from Jesus right now? Would you like to share something for them, please?
There's no way I can show you, but if you trust me, you want Jesus in your life. Like, you need Jesus.
Amen. Hey, Chris, thank you so much. And amen. Amen. It's just been a real joy to see God working in your life and Jesus working in your life and Juana's life, and just excited to see the rest of your journey with Jesus. Thank you. God bless.
Well, thank you very much, Chris, for sharing with us, and thank you, Pastor Roland. These are good stories, aren't they, everyone? Amen. Let's go now up to Gawler, up to the north of our city, and Pastor Jan is here with someone he would like to introduce to us. Thank you, Pastor.
I'm very glad that we are here. It's a challenge to convince people to come here. There are some other people who were supposed to be with us today here, but it was too much. There is Alison, there is Barbara, there is other people who are just afraid to come, but you are brave. And she's not. You see, that's one thing what I appreciate about...
You forced me.
You see, I don't need to introduce Eve, because she introduced herself in such a good way. She is like that every day. So anytime when we are together in Gola, Gola is a little church, we can say it looks like a country church, but I can tell you that Barbara, Eve brought so much, and we are so enriched by her presence. Tell us something about your spiritual journey, because well, you are not like those previous people. You can be my mother, and maybe. And
I feel terrible.
Oh yeah. But I feel that you are bringing something very special from the youth area into the Gola Church. What's your spiritual journey?
Well, it was a long one. A bit different to the other gentlemen when they were speaking. I've been from church to church. I don't really want to name the churches. Okay. I didn't think I would. But I became a nun in the Catholic Church, of course. And after a while, I thought to myself, there's something wrong, very, very wrong. Inside me, I was still empty. I thought I was clean and decent, and I was a nun. It was the best thing to be. But there was this hole inside me, this aching. So one day Barb said to me, is there a church around here that worships on Saturday? I said, yes, there is, the little green one down the road. So we actually came in and I said, this feels like home, this feels good.
Isn't it interesting? This is not we who are going there to reach people. They are coming to us and bringing absolutely enormous experience into our life. And 3 months ago, we had the privilege to go into the baptismal pool, and Eve became our little sister, bringing so much to this church.
Oh, I thought you were trying to drown me. Because you did it twice, didn't you? You know,
it was
down, the water.
It was interesting.
Me.
The day Eve came to the church, she said, Pastor, when it will be, when it will be. I can't wait, I can't wait. And I said, well, wait a moment. We have to go over with some doctrines, some lessons. But she was on fire, and she is still on fire for Jesus. What's the biggest challenge in Seventh-day Adventist Church for you?
Well, I won't say you. I think actually it was coming from what they call the Sabbath, from Sunday to Saturday, and realizing that was Sabbath, but you explained that all to me, and also to untrain my mind from all the law and come into the grace of God, which is entirely different.
Absolutely. You know what we realize? What we realize, important thing is not only to bring people to the church, but also nourish them, study with them. So Thursday morning, for me, it's absolutely a spiritual breakfast. We are always together, and everyone who is attending this group is able to say whatever they want. Sometimes we agree, sometimes we not. But Eve is always there, always challenging us, always bringing this enthusiasm and love for Jesus. So we wish you all the best.
Thank you.
And just share this enthusiasm with us, because we need those people who are 3 months old in spiritual journey to teach us and to help us to be on fire for Jesus. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Eve, and thank you, Pastor Jan. Is this good or is this good, folk? Amen. Let's go to one more church, and let's go down to the Grove. And Leighton has someone he'd like us to meet as well, just coming down the stairs. And I'm really being inspired by younger people, older people, all accepting and understanding and discovering truth. So, Leighton, I'm really interested to meet these folks and listen to their story.
And are you well? Isn't it encouraging today? Chris, thank you so much. And ma'am, who was just here, sorry I didn't catch your name. I was with my children. But thank you, everyone, for sharing. I'd like to introduce to you, can you help me say, good afternoon, Vovo? Yeah, how did you go? Yeah, good, well done. And say, with me, good afternoon to Vovo. Somehow it's different. I don't understand yet, but it's a pleasure to be with you, Jacinta and George. And when you're talking to your mic, make sure it's right up close so the people in the balcony can hear you really clearly. I just want you to imagine for a moment, folks, that you're present in a place called Timor-Leste. And it's 1974, 5, and there's civil unrest in your country. Everyone's disagreeing politically. And seizing the opportunity, the Indonesian army comes across the border. And people who said they were your friend turn on you. And people you love disappear. I want you to place yourself in that situation, because now you're starting to sense a little bit about Jacinta and George's life. And I want you to imagine a beautiful young Indonesian, indigenous schoolgirl. You don't have to imagine very hard, because here she is right here. But then I want you to imagine a bit more older, mature Portuguese gentleman. And here he is. And I want you to imagine their sense of despair as I ask them this first question. Jacinta, what is it like to be trusting God and fleeing away from a civil war?
Well, can they hear me?
Yeah, yes. They can hear you.
Well, at that time, I didn't really know God that much, but I believe God was with me always, and I believe He led me to this neutral zone, which I think He planned this container ship boat to come and rescue us and brought us here to Australia, and we landed in Darwin. After 24 hours.
So you didn't know him personally, but you sensed.
I didn't know personally, but looking back, I know he was with me.
Mm.
You know, God was with me all the time, but which I didn't know he was there. I didn't know this God that I can ask and
yes.
He reveals and he can provide. Didn't know about that. Now I know.
Oh, I know too. Having been getting to know you, George, they let you on the container ship. They didn't at first. Can you tell us what happened, how they snuck you on there?
Well, it's quite a long story to tell, but in short, I had to be...
Short vision.
In short, I have to be smuggling.
Smuggled on.
Or smuggled on.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Onto the container ship.
Okay.
So... Once I was on a container ship, then I had to go and look for a place to hide. And then I went to see Jacinta. She was there. She was crying.
No, you only come out when the container ship start moving.
I love these two. Well, I love these two. No shame, no shame.
No, it was...
Because otherwise you'll be taken out of the ship back
George,
to the land.
George's
yeah, well, it was quite a few years ago.
Isn't it good, George, to have a woman to edit your stories for you?
40 years ago, that's quite...
Let me ask you another question. George, how do you exercise faith and trust in God? You have a choice to make. The government in Australia said Portugal or Sydney?
I left that decision to my wife.
Oh, you meant... Okay, no. So you left that decision like a wise man to your wife.
That's right.
How do you make a decision like that, Jacinda?
No, again, God was there with me. He put the words in my mouth because I just clicked.
You believe, yeah.
I did not think twice. I just said, Sydney.
Okay.
And that's it. We land in Sydney.
And from there,
here
we are.
From there again, he had a plan for us to come to Adelaide.
Amen. I believe you. Before they even knew their song, church family, their hearts were singing. Whatever my lot. Before you even knew, your heart was singing.
Yes. It was loud.
And so we fast forward to Adelaide, and you guys are here. You eventually move from Sydney to Adelaide. And George, I want to ask you, I know you have a passion about meeting with your creator in your garden, among the chilies and the lemons and the mandarins and the... Oh, you should see it. It's amazing. But George, what is it about your garden? Why do you love meeting with Jesus in your garden? What is it about that experience for you?
Well, that's where you see God. Just have a look at one leaf. Just a leaf.
One leaf.
Just a leaf.
Yeah. And you see, you can see his fingerprints there.
That's right. Yeah. You see God there.
Yeah.
You just see God. This in us. Look. Same soil.
Yeah.
And you have different trees.
Yeah.
You know, each tree with a leaf.
Yes.
Yeah. So.
So you enjoy meeting with him there?
Just watch out.
Many times in our Bible studies, George would bring us back to Leighton, I have one king, I have one creator. And so I wanted to make sure
He's the only one.
Yeah, see, I told you. He's the only one.
He's the only one.
Jacinta, how was it that you met Jesus through Wi-Fi on an iPad? Tell us just quickly, briefly about meeting Jesus on your iPad.
Well, I suppose... God, yes, I think he had a plan for me to go there. But the what I was looking for was to watch biblical movies. But instead, he said, no, you're not watching biblical movies. You're going to watch this prohibited program, which he showed me, to how to worship.
Okay, on worship. And the Bible, was it teaching from the Bible?
No, it was the program about worshipping, about all about idols.
Oh, okay.
And then, taught me how to, you know, to not worship any kind of idols.
Right.
So.
Now, growing up in a Roman Catholic environment, as you did in East Timor, this was maybe confronting for you.
Was confronting and shocked.
Yeah.
Because I was... every day praying to this God that wasn't a real God, the God that couldn't hear me and couldn't see me and couldn't feel me and couldn't walk and couldn't talk to me. Mm. I was praying to this God every day, night and day.
So you found him on the iPad?
I found him in the iPad,
and
Jesus.
From there,
he led me to altar fight.
Yeah, okay.
And watch and... He was on about the Bibles,
yes.
comparing
Did you
catch the Bibles.
Walter Veith, Jacinta found Walter Veith.
He was talking about the Bibles, comparing the Bibles that we're not supposed to take God's word and add God's word.
Okay.
So from there, I said, no way I'm going to worship any more idols because I found God. Oh. I found Jesus.
Okay. Amen.
You know?
And Jacinta told me one day about bundling up a whole heap of things she had in her home and putting them in a big plastic bag and walking to the rubbish bin and just...
No, but that was after watching that program about idols.
Very good.
So I went there and just took everything, put it in a bag and put it in the bin. I said, I'm not worshipping these idols anymore. I am worshipping the real God up there in heaven that I can talk to. And he can hear me.
Amen.
You know?
And so you're being hard on us. We have to cut for time, but there's many more things I'd love for you to share. But maybe one last thing would be at your baptism a few weeks ago, can you just share with us something special that was incredible for you, either on the day or leading up to the day? What did the baptism mean for you?
Well, baptism needs for me. I need to get baptized and live in Jesus and Jesus live in me and follow him and do his work.
Amen. And George, your baptism, was it a special day for you too?
Very special. To be with him.
To be with him.
To be with him. Follow him.
Yeah, you can have all this world.
Follow him.
But give me.
Be with me.
Yes. Amen.
Simple as that.
Can you help me thank these two for sharing their story? Thanks,
guys. Thank you so much for listening. Happy Sabbath.
Well, thank you so much for sharing your story with us. We have listened to six people share their story about their journey to Jesus. And I don't know about you, but I get all excited about this. And I think to myself, how many more people are there out there like these six people that we've just heard from this afternoon? There must be lots more. And I just want to suggest to us that we live in incredibly momentous times. I don't know if you, when you listen to the news, when you read your newspapers, you can see what's happening. Economically, our planet is living on a knife edge. Rupert Murdoch just said a little while ago, he warned that the world is on the brink of another world crisis. He said central banks have very little ammunition if the world heads into recession. And we are teetering financially on the end of another collapse. Australia's debt, at the end of 2014, Australia's net government debt was $239.16 billion. Last year, our debt rose by a whopping 34.6%. In December 2014, Australia paid $39.3 million every day on interest on loans. This is the government I'm talking about. Now, people, that is a lot of money. Financially, we're struggling. 4 years ago, I had never heard of the word ISIS or ISIL. But now it's on everyone's lips. And what they are attempting to do, it appears to me, is destabilize the world. And we're living in horrific times. Europe is awash with people who are fleeing persecution, who are fleeing hard times. And as you know, Europe has no idea what to do. They're trying, but they don't know what to do. And this story, this picture here that flashed around the world just filled our hearts with sadness. People looking for freedom, for hope, for a new life. And they lose their little boy. And you look around the world today and you can see that 39 million people have been forced to leave their homes because of conflict or natural disaster. There are 10 million refugees. There are 29 million internally displaced persons. And you wonder to yourself, where is this going to end? And I'd like to say to us all, my friends, welcome to the end times, because we are here. It's happening all around us, and we need to be aware of what's going on. And remember this man. Things are happening and unfolding before our eyes, which we really don't know too much about. But I do know this. Last year, Shimon Peres, who is an ex-president of Israel, met with the Pope and he floated the idea of a UN-style united religions. And this happened at the end of last year. And his idea was, and we won't read it all, what he wants to do is start a world church. because he said the UNO has failed us. What we need now is to have a united religion around the world. And he says, I'll read the last paragraph there, Perez, who gave no details on how the Organization of World Religions would be formed or its representatives chosen, also said in the interview he believed Pope Francis should head it because he is perhaps the only leader who is truly respected. And you can see why he would say that. So, my friends, things that I have learnt when I was a boy listening to my father and my grandfather preach is being fulfilled before our very eyes as our world continues to unravel. But you know, the good news is this. Jesus himself said this, and this gospel of the kingdom, what? Will be preached in all the world for a witness to all nations, and then the end will come. And so, my friends, God has called us. He's called you and he's called me to be his disciples, to be his followers, to live for Jesus, to talk for Jesus, to share Jesus, because the end is coming, and it's coming sooner than I think we ever realize. Ellen White says the last movements will be rapid ones. And it will happen, my friends, very, very, very quickly. This afternoon we want to just talk about how we can reach our friends, how we can reach our neighbours, what is the best way to share the good news for Jesus. Great Controversy, page 606, says this, and I love this quote, by thousands of voices all over the world, the warning will be given. Servants of God, that's us, my friends, servants of God, with their faces lighted up and shining with holy consecration, will hasten from place to place to proclaim the message of heaven. Thousands upon thousands will listen. We've only heard six people today. Thousands upon thousands will listen who have never heard words like these before. So, my friends, there are people out there wanting to know what you and I know, wanting to have the hope that you and I have, wanting to have the joy that you and I have, because, my friends, Jesus is coming soon. The second last verse of the last chapter of the last book in the Bible has Jesus saying, I am coming soon. May God bless us as we live for him, as we share his word for others, is our prayer.
By those testimonies. Were you blessed by those testimonies? Yes, I know as I sat there, as we all sat there in the front, we were just there sitting moved and reignited to be reminded of how much God loves us and he's pursuing us. Thank you to all of you who have shared your testimonies with us. Thank you for that sermon. Behold, he is coming soon. This last song is a collection of songs that we've arranged to put together because it reminds us of how much we love Jesus. He'd rather have him more than anything in this world. Great is his faithfulness for us, that even in our trials, he's with us and he has a bigger plan than this world for us. He has eternity in mind for each and every one of us. He says in his word, in this world, you will have trouble, but what? Does anybody know? Take heart, for he has overcome the world. No matter what troubles lie ahead, as we see the end time events unfold, we can rest assured God's got us.
Vast domain, or be held
back to prayer again. Our loving Father in heaven, Lord, this afternoon we thank you for you. We thank you that you are there. We thank you, Father, for your huge beating heart of love, for your faithfulness and for your goodness. We thank you that you are guiding us and blessing us. Father, we thank you for Jesus, Creator God, who came down and took on the form of a human to take our place and to be with us. Father, we thank you for your Holy Spirit who lives within us, guiding us and blessing us, who is working in this world to lead men and women to Jesus, to the foot of the cross. And Father, we've been inspired as we've heard just a few stories this afternoon about people who have listened to your voice, who have listened to the Spirit. And Lord, we just pause to pray for them, each one, that you will please continue to bless them, be with them, that Father God, you will keep them safe. Lord, we live in momentous times. Things are happening all around us so quickly that we are struggling to keep up. And Father, we know it can all roll into very end time events very, very quickly. And Father, I just pray for us. I pray, Lord, for every head that is bowed here, that you'll keep us faithful to you, that you'll help us to seek your face. Father, we want to be ready as we walk with you, as we surrender our lives to you, as we follow you in everything that we do and say. Father, may we not give the devil a foothold, but Lord, we choose you. If any here are discouraged, who are finding the way hard, may they even now just reach out and say, God, just help me, be with me, bless me, and give me hope and meaning and guide me in my life. So, Lord, thank you for your presence. Thank you for your love. Thank you for hearing our prayers. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.